So, Chapter 26, The Great West and the Agricultural Revolution, 1865 to 1896. You want to note that these are the same dates, roughly, as the other couple of chapters before this, so we're still dealing with the overlapping era of Reconstruction, the Gilded Age, but we're going to be talking about the West, and particularly issues with farmers. And some three overriding themes of this chapter to be looking for is Native American policy, American Native American policy, the myth versus the reality of the West, and then the last section will deal with economic recession panic and people, the farmers, and the populists, and then the election of 1896. From my class, we will be dealing mostly with the Indian policy for our debate that we're doing, and we will return to the latter half of this chapter in a couple weeks. So, Chapter 26. When the Civil War crashed to a close, the frontier line was still wavering westward. A long fringe of settlement, bulging outward here and there, ran roughly north through central Texas onto the Canadian border. Between this jagged line and the settled areas on the Pacific slope, there were virtually no white people. The few exceptions were the islands of Mormons in Utah, occasionally trading posts and gold camps, and several scattered Spanish-Mexican settlements throughout the Southwest. Sprawling in expanse, the Great West was a rough square that measured about 1,000 miles on each side. Embracing mountains, plateaus, deserts, and plains, it was the habitat of the Indian, the buffalo, the wild horse, the prairie dog, and the coyote. 25 years later, that is, by 1890, the entire domain had been carved into states and four territories of Utah, Arizona, New Mexico, and Indian Territory, or Oklahoma. Pioneers flung themselves greedily on this enormous prize as if to ravish it. Probably never before in human experience had so huge an area been transformed so rapidly. The clash of cultures on the plains. Native Americans numbered about 360,000 in 1860. Many of them scattered about in vast grasslands of the trans-Missouri West. But to their eternal misfortune, the Indians stood in the path of the advancing white pioneers. An inevitable clash loomed between an acquisitive, industrializing civilization and the Indians' highly evolved lifeways, adapted over centuries to the demanding environment of the sparsely watered western plains. Migration and conflict, and sometimes dramatic cultural change, were no strangers in the arid West, even before the whites began to arrive. The Comanches had driven the Apaches off the central plains into the upper Rio Grande Valley in the 18th century. Harried by the Mandans and Chippewas, the Cheyenne had abandoned their villages along the upper reaches of the Mississippi and Missouri rivers in the century before the Civil War. The Sioux, displaced from the Great Lakes woodlands in the late 18th century, emerged onto the plains to prey upon the Crows, Kiowas, and Pawnees. Mounted on Spanish-introduced horses, people like the Cheyenne and the Sioux transformed themselves within just a few generations from foot-traveling, crop-growing villagers to wide-ranging nomadic traders and deadly efficient buffalo hunters, so deadly that they threatened to extinguish the vast bison herds that had lured them onto the plains in the first place. When white soldiers and settlers edged onto the plains in the decades just before the Civil War, they had accelerated a fateful cycle that exacerbated already fierce enmities among the Indians and ultimately undermined the foundations of Native American culture. White intruders unwittingly spread cholera, typhoid, and smallpox among the native peoples of the plains with devastating results. Equally harmful, whites put further pressure on the steadily shrinking bison population by hunting and by grazing their own livestock on the prairie grasses. As the once mammoth buffalo herds dwindled, warfare intensified among the plains tribes for ever scarcer hunting grounds. I am traveling all over this country, and I am cutting the trees of my brothers, an Arikara Indian told the U.S. Army officer along the Platte River in 1835. I am killing their buffalo before my friends arrive, so that when they come up, they can find no buffalo. The federal government tried to pacify the Plains Indians by signing treaties with the chiefs of various tribes at Fort Laramie in 1851 and at Fort Atkinson in 1853. The treaties marked the beginnings of the reservation system in the West. They established boundaries for the territory of each tribe and intended to separate the Indians into two great colonies to the north and south of a corridor of intended white settlement. So I want to pause for a minute, just a quick note, there's a kind of a progression of Indian policy here. The first one here is to sign treaties with these people that they just pick people and call them chiefs, and to try to put them onto reservations. So this is what's known as the reservation system. And that's what we do in the mid-1800s, the reservation system. Back to the reading. But the white treaty makers misunderstood both Indian government and Indian society. Tribes and chiefs were often fictions of the white imagination, which could not grasp the fact that Native Americans, living in scattered bands, usually recognized no authority outside their immediate family or perhaps a village elder. And the nomadic culture of the Plains Indians was utterly alien to the concept of living out one's life in the confinement of a defined territory. In the 1860s, the federal government intensified this policy and herded the Indians into still smaller confines, principally the Great Sioux Reservation in Dakota Territory and Indian Territory in present-day Oklahoma, into which dozens of southern plains tribes were forced. The Indians surrendered their ancestral lands only when they had received solemn promises from Washington that they would be left alone and provided with food, clothing, and other supplies. Regrettably, the federal Indian agents were often corrupt. They palmed off moth-eaten blankets, spoiled beef, and defective provisions on the friendless Indians. One of these cheating officials, on an annual salary of $1,500, returned home after 4 years with an estimated savings of $50,000. For more than a decade after the Civil War, fierce warfare between Indians and the U.S. Army raged in various parts of the West. Army troops, many of them recent immigrants who had ironically fled Europe to avoid military service, met formidable adversaries in the Plains Indians, whose superb horsemanship gave them baffling mobility. Fully one-fifth of all U.S. Army personnel on the frontier were African-American, dubbed Buffalo Soldiers by the Indians, supposedly because of the resemblance of their hair to the bison's fur coat. So I want to pause here for a moment. All this military action is happening roughly at the same time as Reconstruction. So when we talk about the lack of federal troops in the South, part of it was because of the pull that the troops were needed out west to deal with Indians. Receding Native Population. The Indian Wars in the West were often savage clashes. Aggressive whites sometimes shot peaceful Indians on sight just to make sure they would give no trouble. At Sand Creek, Colorado in 1864, Colonel J.M. Shivington's militia massacred in cold blood some 400 Indians who apparently thought they had been promised immunity. Women were shot praying for mercy, children had their brains dashed out, and braves were tortured, scalped, and unspeakably mutilated. This is the Sand Creek Massacre, 1864. Cruelty begot cruelty. In 1866, a Sioux war party attempted to block construction of the Bozeman Trail to the Montana goldfields, ambushed Captain William J. Fetterman's command of 81 soldiers and civilians in Wyoming's Bighorn Mountains. The Indians left not a single survivor and grotesquely mutilated the corpses. This is in Bighorn. One trooper's face was split with 105 arrows. George Armstrong Custer, the buckskin-clad boy general of Civil War fame, now demoted to colonel and turned Indian fighter, wrote that Fetterman's annihilation awakened a bitter feeling toward the savage perpetrators. The cycle of ferocious warfare intensified. The Fetterman Massacre led to one of the few, though short-lived, Indian triumphs in the Plains Wars. In another Treaty of Fort Laramie, signed in 1868, the government abandoned the Bozeman Trail. The sprawling Great Sioux Reservation was guaranteed to the Sioux tribes, but in 1874, a new round of warfare with the Plains Indians began when Custer led a scientific expedition into the Black Hills of South Dakota, part of the Sioux Reservation, and announced that he had discovered gold. Hordes of greedy gold seekers swarmed into the Sioux lands. The aggrieved Sioux took to the warpath, inspired by the influential and wildly Sitting Bull. Colonel Custer's 7th Cavalry, nearly half of them immigrants, set out to suppress the Indians and to return them to the reservation. Attacking what turned out to be a superior force of some 2,500 well-armed warriors camped along the Little Bighorn River in present-day Montana, the white chief with yellow hair, this is Custer, and his 264 officers and men were completely wiped out in 1876 when two supporting columns failed to come to the rescue. But in a series of battles across the northern plains in the ensuing months, the U.S. Army relentlessly hunted down the Indians who had humiliated Custer. One band of Nez Perce Indians in northeastern Oregon were goaded into daring flight in 1877 when U.S. authorities tried to herd them onto the reservation. Chief Joseph finally surrendered his breakaway band of some 700 Indians after a torturous 1,700-mile, 3-month trek across the Continental Divide toward Canada. There, Joseph hoped to rendezvous with Sitting Bull, who had taken refuge north of the border after the Battle of Little Bighorn. Betrayed into believing they would be returned to their ancestral lands in Idaho, the Nez Perce, instead, were sent to a dusty reservation in Kansas, where 40% of them perished from disease. The survivors were eventually allowed to return to Idaho. Fierce Apache tribes of Arizona and New Mexico were the most difficult to subdue. Led by Geronimo, whose eyes blazed hatred of the whites, they were pursued into Mexico by federal troops using sun-flashing heliograph, a communication device that impressed the Indians as big medicine. Scattered remnants of the warriors were finally persuaded to surrender after the Apache women had been exiled to Florida. The Apaches ultimately became successful farmers in Oklahoma. This relentless fire and sword policy of the whites at last shattered the spirit of the Indians. They vanquished Native Americans. The vanquished Native Americans were finally ghettoized on reservations where they could theoretically preserve their cultural autonomy, but were in fact compelled to eke out a sullen existence as wards on the government. Their white masters had at last discovered that the Indians were much cheaper to feed than to fight. Even so, for many decades, they were almost ignored to death. The taming of the Indians was engineered by a number of factors. Of cardinal importance was the railroad, which shot an iron arrow through the heart of the West. Locomotives could bring out unlimited numbers of troops, farmers, cattlemen, sheep herders, and settlers. The Indians were also ravaged by the white people's diseases, to which they showed little resistance, and by their fire water, to which they showed almost no resistance. Above all, the virtual extermination of the buffalo doomed the Plains Indians' nomadic way of life. So three factors before we move on. One, the railroads. Two, white people's diseases and alcohol. And three, the white near wiping out of the bison destroyed the way of life of Indians. Bellowing herds of bison. Tens of millions of buffalo, described by early Spaniards as hunchback cows, blackened the western prairies when the white Americans first arrived. These shaggy, lumbering animals were the staff of life for Native Americans. Their flesh provided food. Their dried dung provided fuel. Their hides provided clothing, lariats, and harnesses. When the Civil War closed, some 15 million of these meaty beasts were still grazing on the western plains. In 1868, a Kansas Pacific locomotive had to wait 8 hours for a herd to amble across the tracks. Much of the food supply of the railroad construction gangs came from leathery buffalo steaks. William Buffalo Bill Cody, sinewy, telescope-eyed, and a crack shot, killed over 4,000 animals in 18 months while employed by the Kansas Pacific. With the building of the railroad, the massacre of the herds began in deadly earnest. The creatures were slain for their hides, for their tongues, or a few of their choice cuts, or for the sheer amusement of it. Sportsmen on lurching railroad trains would lean out windows and blaze away at the animals to satisfy their lust for slaughter or excitement. Such wholesale butchery left fewer than 1,000 buffalo alive by 1885, and the once numerous beasts were in danger of complete extinction. The whole story is a shocking example of the greed and waste that accompanied the conquest of the continent. The end of the trail. By the 1880s, the national conscience began to stir uneasily over the plight of the Indians. Helen Hunt Jackson, a Massachusetts writer of children's literature, pricked the moral sense of the Americans in 1881 when she published A Century of Dishonor. The book chronicled the sorry record of government ruthlessness and chicanery in dealing with the Indians. Her later novel, Ramona, in 1884, a love story of injustice to the Californian Indians, sold some 600,000 copies and further inspired sympathy for Indians. Debate seesawed. Humanitarians wanted to treat the Indians kindly and persuade them thereby to walk the white man's road. Yet hardliners insisted on the current policy of forced containment and brutal punishment. Neither side showed much respect for Native American culture. Christian reformers, who often administered educational facilities on the reservations, sometimes withheld food to force the Indians to give up their tribal religion and assimilate to white society. In 1884, these zealous white souls joined with military men in successfully persuading the federal government to outlaw the sacred sun dance. When the ghost dance cult later spread to the Dakota Sioux, the army bloodily stamped it out in 1890 at the so-called Battle of Wounded Knee. In the fighting thus provoked, an estimated 200 Indian men, women, and children were killed, as well as 29 invading soldiers. The misbegotten offspring of the movement to the reform Indian policy was the Dawes Severalty Act of 1887. Reflecting the forced civilization views of the reformers, the act dissolved many tribes as legal entities, wiped out tribal ownership of land, and set up individual Indian family heads with 160 free acres. The Indians behaved themselves like good white settlers. If they did this, they would get a full title to their holdings as well as citizenship. In 25 years, the probationary period was later extended, but full citizenship was granted to all Indians in 1924. So the Dawes Severalty Act changes the policy from reservations to assimilation, forced assimilation. Reservation land not allotted to the Indians under the Dawes Act, was to be sold to railroads and to white settlers, with the proceeds used by the federal government to educate and civilize the native peoples. In 1879, the government had already funded the Carlisle Indian School in Pennsylvania, where Native American children, separated from their tribes, were taught English and inculcated with white values and customs. Kill the Indian and save the man was the school's founder's motto. In the 1890s, the government expanded its network of Indian boarding schools and sent field matrons to the reservations to teach Native American women the art of sewing and to preach the virtues of chastity and hygiene. The Dawes Act struck directly at tribal organization and tried to make rugged individualists out of the Indians. This legislation ignored the inherent reliance of traditional Indian culture on tribally held land, literally pulling the land out from under them. By 1900, Indians had lost 50% of the 156 million acres they had held just two decades earlier. The forced assimilation doctrine of the Dawes Act remained the cornerstone of the government's official Indian policy for nearly a half a century until... Until the Indian Reorganization Act, the Indian New Deal of 1934, partially reversed the individualistic approach and belatedly tried to restore the tribal basis of Indian life. Under these new federal policies, defective though they were, the Indian population started to mount slowly. The total number had been reduced by 1887 to about 243,000, the results of bullets, bottles, and bacteria. But the census of 2000 counted more than a million and a half Native Americans, urban and rural. So again, from reservations to forced assimilation, the Dawes Act was an attempt to respond to some of those reformers and be more kinder and gentle on the Indians. But what that meant was to try to Christianize them and make them white. It also stole a fair amount of land from them as well. A little footnote, the Dawes Act was named after a Massachusetts senator from Pittsfield. I live on a street named after him. So, for what it's worth, the Dawes Act. Okay, from my crew doing the debate on imperialism, this is where we'll stop for as far as taking over land and imperialism on the continent. For the rest of everyone else who's listening to this, and for my crew later on, we'll continue. Mining, from dishpan to ore breaker. The conquest of the Indians and the coming of the railroad were life-giving boons to the mining frontier. The golden gravel of California continued to yield pay dirt, and in 1858, an electrifying discovery convulsed Colorado. Avid 59ers, or peakers, rushed west to rip at the ramparts of the Rockies. But there were more miners than minerals, and many gold grubbers, with Pike's Peak or Bust inscribed on the canvas of their covered wagons, creaked wearily back with the added inscription, "Busted by Gosh." Yet countless bearded fortune seekers stayed on, some to strip away the silver deposits, others to extract non-metallic wealth from the earth in the form of golden grain. 59ers also poured feverishly into Nevada in 1859 after the fabulous Comstock lode had been uncovered. A fantastic amount of gold and silver worth more than $340 million was mined by the kings of the Comstock from 1860 to 1890. The scantily populated state of Nevada, child of the Comstock lode, was prematurely railroaded into the Union in 1864, partly to provide three electoral votes for President Lincoln. Smaller lucky strikes drew frantic gold and silver seekers into Montana, Idaho, and other western states. Boom towns, known as Helorados, sprouted from the desert sands like magic. Every third cabin was a saloon where sweat-stained miners drank adulterated liquor in the company of accommodating women. Lynch law and hempeg vigilante justice, as in early California, preserved a crude semblance of order in the towns, and when the diggings petered out, the gold seekers decamped, leaving eerily picturesque ghost towns, such as Virginia City, Nevada, silhouetted in the desert. Begun with a boom, these towns ended with a whimper. Once the loose surface gold was gobbled up, ore-breaking machinery was imported to smash the gold-bearing quartz. This operation was so expensive that it could ordinarily be undertaken only by corporations pooling the wealth of stockholders. Gradually, the age of big business came to the mining industry. Dusty, bewhiskered miners, dishpans in hand, were replaced by the impersonal corporations with their costly machinery and trained engineers. The once independent gold washer became just another day laborer. So this is another crucial trend. In the West, it starts out with these rugged individualists on state land, and then eventually it becomes corporations taking it over, which is a similar trend to the rest of the Gilded Age, as you may recall. Yet the mining frontier had played a vital role in subduing the continent. Magnet-like, it attracted population and wealth while advertising the wonders of the Wild West. Women, as well as men, found opportunity, running boarding houses or working as prostitutes. They won a kind of equality on the rough frontier that earned them the voting rights in Wyoming, Utah, and Colorado, and in Idaho, long before their sisters in the East could cast a ballot. The amassing of precious metals helped finance the Civil War, facilitated the building of railroads, and intensified the already bitter conflict between whites and Indians. The outpouring of silver and gold enabled the Treasury to resume specie payments in 1879 and injected the silver issue into the American politics. Silver senators, representing the thinly peopled acreage states of the West, used their disproportionate influence to promote the interests of these silver miners. Finally, the mining frontier added to American folklore and literature, as the writings of Bret Hart and Mark Twain so colorfully attest. So just a quick flashback on that paragraph. The specie payments are payments in actual coinage, and the silver issue became the notion that not just the gold standard should be used, but we should also start coining silver, which would cause inflation. It would help people in debt, because it would be easier to pay off your debts if there's more money around. But the bankers in the East did not like this idea. This will come up later in the chapter. Beef bonanzas and the long drive. When the Civil War ended, the grassy plains of Texas supported several million tough, long-horned cattle. These scrawny beasts, whose horns spread sometimes reach 8 feet, were killed primarily for their hides. There was no way of getting their meat profitably to market. The problem of marketing was neatly solved when the transcontinental railroads thrust their iron fingers into the West. Cattle could now be shipped bodily to the stockyards, and under the beef barons like the Swifts and Armors, the highly industrialized meatpacking business sprang into existence as a main pillar of the economy. Drawing upon the gigantic stockyards at Kansas City and Chicago, the meatpackers could ship their fresh products to the East Coast in the newly perfected refrigerator cars. Again, a railroad creating mass markets for cattle and beef. A spectacular feeder of the new slaughterhouses were the long drive. Texas cowboys, black, white, and Mexican, drove herds numbering from 1,000 to 10,000 head slowly over the unfenced and unpeopled plains until they reached a railroad terminal. The bawling beast grazed en route on the free government grass. Favorite terminal points were fly-speckled cow towns like Dodge City, the bilboes Babylon of the frontier, in Abilene, Kansas, Ogallala, Nebraska, and Cheyenne, Wyoming. At Abilene, order was maintained by Marshal James B. Wild Bill Hickok, a fabulous gunman who reportedly killed only in self-defense or in the line of duty, and who was fatally shot in the back in 1876 while playing poker. As long as the lush grass was available, the long drive proved profitable, that is, to the luckier cattlemen who escaped Indians, stampedes, cattle fever, and other hazards. From 1866 to 1888, bellowing herds totaling over 4 million steers were driven northward from the Beef Bowl of Texas. Their steer was king in the cattle kingdom, richly carpeted with grass. What the Lord giveth, the Lord also can taketh away. The railroad made the long drive, primarily because the locomotives ran both ways. The same rails that bore the cattle from the open range to the kitchen range brought out the homesteader and the sheepherder. Both of these intruders, sometimes amid flying bullets, built barbed wire fences that were too numerous to be cut down by the cowboys. Furthermore, the terrible winter of 1886 and 87, with blinding blizzards reaching 68 degrees below zero, left thousands of dazed cattle starving and freezing. Overexpansion and overgrazing likewise took their toll, as the cowboys slowly gave way to plowboys. So the cowboy long drive thing was only temporary, because you had homesteaders coming out because of the railroad. You had then their barbed wire fences, as well as this blizzard that pretty much wiped everything out. And then third, you had overgrazing, which pretty much prevented them from using the grass. The only escape for the stockmen was to make cattle raising a big business and avoid the perils of overproduction. Breeders learned to fence their ranches, lay in winter feed, import blooded bulls, and produce fewer and meatier animals. They also learned to organize. The Wyoming Stock Growers Association, especially in the 1880s, virtually controlled the state and its legislature. This was the heyday of the cowboy. The equipment of the cowhand, from the shooting irons and the 10-gallon hats to chaps and spurs, served as a useful, not ornamental function. A genuine gun-toting cowpuncher riding where men and smelled like horses could justifiably boast of his toughness. These bow-legged knights of the saddle, with their colorful trappings and cattle-lulling songs, became part of American folklore. Many of them, perhaps 5,000, were blacks, who especially enjoyed the newfound freedom of the open range. The Farmer's Frontier. Miners and cattlemen created the romantic legend of the West, but it was the sober sodbuster who wrote the final chapter of frontier history. A fresh day dawned for Western farmers with the Homestead Act of 1862. The Homestead Act of 1862, middle of the Civil War. The new law allowed a settler to acquire as much as 160 acres of land by living on it for 5 years, improving it, and paying a nominal fee of about $30. The Homestead Act marked a drastic departure from previous policy. Before the Act, public land had been sold primarily for revenue. Now it was to be given away to encourage a rapid filling of empty spaces and to provide a stimulus to the family farm, the backbone of democracy. The new law was a godsend to a host of farmers who could not afford to buy large holdings. During the 40 years after its passage, about 500,000 families took advantage of the Homestead Act to carve out new homes in the vast open stretches. Yet five times as many families purchased their land from the railroads, the land companies, or the states. So just to pause real quick, farmers moving out west purchased their land from the Homestead Act, but also railroad companies, land companies, and actual individual states who own the land. The Homestead Act often turned out to be a cruel hoax. The standard 160 acres, quite adequate in the well-watered Mississippi Basin, frequently proved pitifully inadequate on the rain-scarce Great Plains. Thousands of homesteaders, perhaps two out of three, were forced to give up the one-sided struggle against drought. Uncle Sam, it was said, bet 160 acres against $10 that the settlers could not live on their homesteads for 5 years. One of these unsuccessful gambles in Greer County, western Oklahoma, inspired a folk song, "Hurrah for Greer County, the land of the free, the land of the bedbug, grasshopper, and flea. I'll sing of its praises, I'll tell of its fame, while starving to death on my government claim." Naked fraud was spawned by the Homestead Act and similar laws. Perhaps 10 times more of the public domain wound up in the clutches of land-grabbing promoters than in the hands of bona fide farmers. Unscrupulous corporations would use dummy homesteaders, often their employees or aliens, bribed with cash and a bottle of beer, to grab the best properties containing timber, minerals, and oil. Settlers would later swear that they had improved the property by erecting a 12-by-14 dwelling, which turned out to be 12 by 14 inches. So again, corruption, corporations, Gilded Age, right? The railways also played a major role in developing the agricultural West, largely through the profitable marketing of crops. Some railroad companies induced Americans and European immigrants to buy the cheap lands earlier granted by the government. The Northern Pacific Railroad, at one time, had nearly 1,000 paid agents in Europe distributing roseate leaflets in various languages. Shattering the myth of the Great American Desert opened the gateways to the agricultural West even wider. The windswept prairies were, for the most part, treeless, and the tough sod had been pounded by millions of buffalo hooves. Pioneer explorers and trappers had assumed that the soil must be sterile simply because it was not heavily watered and did not support immense forest. But once the prairie sod was broken with heavy iron plows pulled by four yokes of oxen, the plow that broke the plains, the earth proved astonishingly fruitful. Sod busters poured onto the prairies. Lacking trees for lumber and fuel, they built homes from the very sod they dug from the ground and burned corn cobs for warmth. Lured by higher wheat prices resulting from crop failures elsewhere in the world, settlers in the 1870s rashly pushed still farther west onto the poor, marginal lands beyond the 100th meridian. That imaginary line, running north to south from the Dakotas through West Texas, separated two climatological regions, a well-watered area to the east and a semi-arid area to the west. Bewhiskered and one-armed geologist John Wesley Powell, explorer of the Colorado River's Grand Canyon and director of the U.S. Geological Survey, warned in 1874 that beyond the 100th meridian, so little rain fell that agriculture was impossible without massive irrigation. Ignoring Powell's advice, farmers heedlessly chewed up the crusty earth in the western part, in western Kansas, eastern Colorado, and Montana. They quickly went broke as a 6-year drought in the 1880s further dissected the already dusty region. Western Kansas lost half its population between 1888 and 1892. "There is no God west of Salina," one hapless homesteader declared. In the wake of the devastating drought, the new technique of dry farming took root on the plains. Its method of frequent shallow cultivation supposedly were adapted to the arid western environment. But over time, dry farming created a finely pulverized surface soil that contributed to the notorious Dust Bowl several decades later. Other adaptations to the western environment were more successful. Tough strains of wheat, resistant to cold and drought, were imported from Russia and blossomed in the billowing yellow carpets. wise farmers abandoned corn in favor of sorghum and other drought-resistant grains. Barbed wire, perfected by Joseph Glidden in 1874, solved the problem of how to build fences on the treeless prairies. Eventually, federally financed irrigation projects on a colossal scale, beyond even what John Wesley Powell had dreamed, caused the American desert to bloom. A century after Powell's predictions, arching dams had tamed the Missouri and Columbia rivers, and so penned up and diverted the canyon-gnawing Colorado that its mouth in the Gulf of California was dry. More than 45 million acres were irrigated in 17 western states. In the long run, the hydraulic engineers had more to do with shaping of the modern West than all the trappers, miners, cavalrymen, and cowboys there ever were. As one engineer boasted, "We enjoy pushing rivers around." So this is, again, the myth of the rugged individualist and the idea that you also need massive corporations with their money to finance a lot of this, as well as massive state and federal government spending on irrigation projects to survive in the West. The Far West comes of age. The Great West experienced a fantastic growth in population from the 1870s to the 1890s. A parade of new Western states proudly joined the Union. Boomtown, Colorado, offspring of the Pikes Peaks gold rush, was greeted in 1876 as the Continental State. No, the Centennial State, 100 years. In 1888 to 1890, a Republican Congress, eagerly seeking more Republican electoral and congressional votes, admitted in a wholesale lot six new states: North Dakota, South Dakota, Montana, Washington, Idaho, and Wyoming. The Mormon Church formally and belatedly banned polygamy in 1890, but not until 1896 was Utah deemed worthy of admission. Only Oklahoma, New Mexico, and Arizona remained to be lifted into statehood from contiguous territory on the mainland of North America. In a last gaudy fling, the federal government made available to settlers vast stretches of fertile plains formerly occupied by the Indians in the District of Oklahoma, the beautiful land. Scores of overeager and well-armed Sooners, illegally jumping the gun, had entered Oklahoma territory. They had to be evicted repeatedly by federal troops, who on occasion would shoot the intruders' horses. On April 22, 1889, all was in readiness for the legal opening of some 50,000 boomers, were poised expectantly on the boundary line. At high noon, the bugle shrilled and the horde of 89ers poured on lathered horses or careening vehicles. That night, a lonely spot on the prairie had mushroomed into the tent city of Guthrie with over 10,000 people. By the end of the year, Oklahoma boasted 60,000 inhabitants and Congress made it a territory. In 1907, it became the Sooner State. And this next part is kind of crucial in terms of American ideology and the frontier. Pay attention to the Turner thesis and its potential accuracy or inaccuracy. The fading frontier. In 1890, a watershed date, the superintendent of the census announced that for the first time in America's experience, a frontier line was no longer discernible. All the unsettled areas were now broken into by isolated bodies of settlement. The quote-unquote closing of the frontier inspired one of the most influential essays ever written about American history, Frederick Jackson Turner's The Significance of the Frontier in American History. In 1893, the significance of the frontier in American history. This is also referred to as the Turner thesis and the closing of the frontier. As the 19th century neared its sunset, the westward tramping American people were disturbed to find that their fabled free land was going or had gone. The Secretary of War had prophesied in 1827 that 500 years would be needed to fill the West. But as the nation finally recognized that its land was not inexhaustible, seeds were planted to preserve the vanishing resource. The government set aside land for national parks, first Yellowstone in 1872, followed by Yosemite and Sequoia in 1890. But the frontier was more than a place. It was also a state of mind and a symbol of opportunity. Its passing ended a romantic phase of the nation's internal development and created new economic and psychological problems. Traditionally footloosed, Americans have been notorious for their mobility. The nation's farmers, unlike the peasants of Europe, have seldom remained rooted to their soil. The land, sold for a profit as settlement closed in, was often the settler's most profitable crop. Much has been said about the frontier as a safety valve. The theory is that when hard times came, the unemployed who cluttered the city's pavements merely moved west, took up farming, and prospered. In truth, Relatively few city dwellers, at least in the populous eastern states, migrated to the frontier during depressions. Most of them did not know how to farm. Few of them could raise enough money to transport themselves west and then pay for the livestock and expensive machinery. But the safety valve theory does have some validity. Free acreage did lure to the west a host of immigrant farmers who otherwise might have remained in the eastern cities to clog the job markets and to crowd the festering and already overpopulated slums. And the very possibility of westward migration may have induced urban employers to maintain wage rates high enough to discourage workers from leaving. But the real safety valve by the late 19th century was in western cities like Chicago, Denver, and San Francisco, where failed farmers, busted miners, and displaced easterners found ways to seek their fortunes. Indeed, after about 1880, the area from the Rocky Mountains to the Pacific Coast was the most urbanized region in America, measured by the percentage of people living in cities. U.S. history cannot be properly understood unless it is viewed in light of the westward moving experience. Here comes the Turner thesis stuff again. As Frederick Jackson Turner wrote, American history has been in a large degree the history of the colonization of the Great West. The story of settling and taming the Trans-Mississippi West in the late 19th century was but the last chapter in the saga of colonizing various American Wests since Columbus's day. From the West Indies to the Chesapeake Shore, from the valleys of the Hudson and Connecticut rivers to the valleys of the Tennessee and Ohio rivers. And yet, the Trans-Mississippi West formed a distinct chapter in that saga and retains even to this day much of its uniqueness. There, the Native American peoples made their last and most desperate struggle against colonization, and there, most Native Americans live today. There, Anglo culture collided most directly with Hispanic culture, the historic rival of the Anglo-Americans for dominance in the New World, and the Southwest remains the most Hispanicized region in America. There, America faced across the Pacific to Asia, and there, most Asian Americans dwell today. There, in the West, the scale and severity of the environment posed the largest challenges to human ambitions, and there, the environment, with its aridity and still magical emptiness, continues to mold social and political life in the American imagination, as in no other part of the nation. And in no other region has the federal government, with its vast landholdings, its subsidies to the railroads, and its massive irrigation projects, played so conspicuous a role in economic and social development. This is pretty crucial. I want to pause for a minute because the West, even to this day, politically does not like government interference in their affairs. They tend to be politically libertarian. However, the irony of this whole thing is that the federal government has probably played the largest role in developing the West than any other region. The westward moving pioneers and the country they confronted have assumed mythical proportions in the American mind. They have been immortalized by such writers as Bret Harte, Mark Twain, Helen Hunt Jackson, and Frances Parkman, and by such painters as George Catlin, Frederick Remington, and Albert Bierstadt. For better or for worse, those pioneers planted the seeds of civilization in the immense western wilderness. The life we live, they dreamed of. The life they lived, we can only dream. The farm becomes a factory. The situation of American farmers, once Jacks and Jills of all trades, was rapidly changing. They had raised their own food, fashioned their own clothing, and bartered for other necessities with neighbors. Now, high prices persuaded farmers to concentrate on growing single cash crops, such as wheat or corn, and use their profits to buy foodstuffs at the general store and manufacture goods in town or by mail order. The Chicago firm of Aaron Montgomery Ward sent out its first catalog, a single sheet, in 1872. Large-scale farmers, especially in the immense grain-producing areas of the Mississippi Valley, were now both specialists as well as business people. As cogs in the vast industrial machine, these farmers were intimately tied to banking, railroading, and manufacturing. They had to buy expensive machinery in order to plant and to harvest their crops. A powerful steam engine could drag behind it simultaneously the plow, seeder, and harrow. The speed of harvesting wheat was dramatically increased in the 1870s by the invention of the twine binder, and then in the 1880s by the combine, the combined reaper thresher, which was drawn by 20 or 40 horses, and which both reaped and bagged the grain. Widespread use of such costly equipment naturally called for first-class management, but the farmers, often unskilled as business people, were inclined to blame the banks and railroads, or the volatility of the global marketplace, rather than their own shortcomings for the losses. So again, you have a huge, important to note that the farm and the farmers are tied to global grain prices and eastern manufacturing and railroad prices. They are no longer isolated out in the farm. Speaking of railroads, here comes my son with Mr. Topham Hatt. All right, Sir Topham Hatt has found a place to park. Continuing on, This amazing mechanization of agriculture in the post-war years was almost as striking as the mechanization of industry. In fact, agricultural modernization drove many marginal farmers off the land, thus swelling the ranks of the new industrial workforce. As the rural population steadily decreased, those farmers who remained achieved miracles of production, making America the world's breadbasket and butcher shop. The farm was attaining the status of a factory, an outdoor grain factory. Bonanza wheat farms of the Minnesota, North Dakota area, for example, were enormous. By 1890, at least a half a dozen of them were larger than 15,000 acres, with communication by telephone from one part to another. These bonanza farms foreshadowed the gigantic agribusiness of the next century. So know the term bonanza farms, large-scale agribusiness, big business farms. Agriculture was a big business from its earliest days in California's phenomenally productive and phenomenally irrigated Central Valley. California farms carved out of giant Spanish-Mexican land grants and the railroad's huge holdings were from the outset more than three times larger than the national average. The reformer Henry George in 1871 described the Golden State as not a country of farms, but a country of plantations and estates. With the advent of the railroad refrigerator car in the 1880s, California fruit and vegetable crops, raised on sprawling tracts by ill-paid migrant Mexican and Chinese farmlands, sold at a handsome profit in the rich urban markets of the East. Deflation dooms the debtor. Once the farmers became chained to a one-crop economy, wheat or corn, they were in the same leaky boat with the southern cotton growers. As long as prices stayed high, all went well. But when they skidded in the 1880s, bankruptcy felt like a blight on the farm belts. The grain farmers were no longer the masters of their own destinies. They were engaged in one of the most fiercely competitive businesses, for the price of their product was determined in a world market by the world output. If the wheat fields of Argentina, Russia, or other foreign countries flourished, the price of the farmers' grain would fall, and American sodbusters would face ruin, as they did in the 1880s and the 1890s. Low prices and a deflated currency were the chief worries of the frustrated farmers, north, south, and west. If a family had borrowed $1,000 in 1855, when the wheat was worth about a dollar a bushel, they expected to pay back the equivalent of 1,000 bushels plus interest when the mortgage fell due. But if they let their debt run to 1890, when the wheat had fallen to about 50 cents a bushel, they would have to pay back the price of 2,000 bushels for the 1,000 they had borrowed, plus interest. This unexpected burden struck them as unjust, though their steely-eyed creditors often branded the complaining farmers as slippery and dishonest rascals. The deflationary pinch on the debtor flowed partially from the static money supply. There was simply not enough dollars to go around, and as a result, prices were forced down. In 1870, the currency in circulation for each person was $19.42. In 1890, it was only $22.67. Yet during these 20 years, business and industrial activity, increasing manyfold, had intensified the scramble for available currency. The forgotten farmers were caught in a treadmill. Despite unremitting toil, they operated year after year at a loss and lived off their fat as best they could. In a vicious circle, their farm machinery increased their output of grain, lowered the price because there was more of it, and drove them deeper and deeper into debt. Mortgages engulfed homesteads at an alarming rate. By 1890, Nebraska alone reported more than 100,000 farms blanketed with mortgages. The repeated crash of the sheriff auctioneer's hammer kept announcing to the world that another sturdy American farmer had become landless in a landed nation. Ruinous rates of interest, running from 8 to 40%, were charged on mortgages, largely by agents of Eastern loan companies. The wind-burned sons and daughters of the sod, who felt they deserved praise for developing the country, cried out in despair against the loan sharks and the Wall Street octopus. Farm tenancy, rather than farm ownership, was spreading like stinkweed. The trend was especially marked in the sharecropping South, where cotton prices also sank dismayingly. By 1880, one-fourth of all American farms were operated by tenants. The United States was ready to feed the world, but under the new industrial feudalism, the farmers were about to sink into a status of suggesting old world serfdom. So the farmers, the next rest of this chapter is about the farmers trying to fight for their fair share against this, what they see as an unjust system. Unhappy farmers. Even Mother Nature ceased smiling as her powerful forces conspired against agriculture. Mile-wide clouds of grasshoppers, leaving nothing but the mortgage, periodically ravaged prairie farms. The terrible cotton boll weevil was also wreaking havoc in the South by the early 1890s. The good earth was going sour. Floods added to the waste of erosion, which had already washed the topsoil off millions of once lush southern acres. Expensive fertilizers were urgently needed. A long succession of droughts seared the Trans-Mississippi West, beginning in the summer of 1887. Whole towns were abandoned. Going home to the wife's folks, and in God we trusted, in Kansas we busted, were typical laments of many impoverished farmers as they fled their weather-beaten shacks and sun-baked sod houses. One irate, quote-unquote, poet snarled, 50 miles to water, 100 miles to wood, to hell with this damn country, I'm going home for good. To add their miseries, the soil tillers were gouged by their government, local, state, and national. Their land was overassessed, and they paid painful local taxes, whereas wealthy Easterners could conceal their stocks and bonds in safe deposit boxes. High protective tariffs in these years poured profits into the pockets of manufacturers. Farmers, on the other hand, had no choice but to sell their low-priced products in a fiercely competitive, unprotected world market, while buying high-priced manufactured goods in a protected home market. The farmers were also farmed by the corporations and processors. They were at the mercy of the Harvester Trust, the Barbed Wire Trust, and the Fertilizer Trust, all of which could control output and raise prices to extortionate levels. Middlemen took a juicy cut from the selling price of the goods that the farmers bought, while operators pushed storage rates to the ceiling at grain warehouses and elevators. In addition, the railroad octopus had the grain growers in its grip. Freight rates could be so high that the farmers sometimes lost less if they burned their corn for fuel than if they shipped it. If they raised their voices in protest, the ruthless railroad operators might let their grain spoil in damp places or refuse to provide them with cars when they needed it. Farmers still made up nearly one half the population in 1890, but they were hopelessly disorganized. The manufacturers and the railroad barons knew how to combine to promote their interest, and so increasingly did industrial workers. But the farmers were by nature independent and individualistic, dead set against consolidation or regimentation. No really effective Carnegie or Gompers arose among them to preach the gospel of economic integration and concentration. They never did organize successfully to restrict production until forced to do so by the federal government, nearly half a century later in Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal days. What they did manage to organize was a monumental political uprising. Just a quick footnote, Carnegie is, of course, the steel magnate who consolidated the steel industry. Gompers was Samuel Gompers, who was the head of the American Federation of Labor, who tried to organize the workers. The farmers take their stand. Agrarian unrest had flared forth earlier in the Greenback movement shortly after the Civil War. Prices sagged in 1868, and a host of farmers unsuccessfully sought relief from low prices and high indebtedness by demanding an inflation of the currency with paper money. The National Grange of the Patrons of Husbandry, better known as the Grange, was organized in 1867. Its leading spirit was Oliver H. Kelly, a shrewd and energetic Minnesota farmer, then working as a clerk in Washington. Kelly's first objective was to enhance the lives of isolated farmers through social, educational, and fraternal activities. Farm men and women, cursed with loneliness in widely separated farmhouses, found the Grange's picnics, concerts, and lectures a godsend. Kelly, a Mason, even found farmers receptive to his mumbo-jumbo of passwords and secret rituals, as well as his four-ply hierarchy, ranging for men from laborer to husbandman, and for women from maid to matron. The Grange spread like an old-time prairie fire, and by 1875 claimed 800,000 members, chiefly in the Midwest and the South. Buzzing with gossip, these calicoed and calloused folk often met in red schoolhouses around potbelly stoves. The Grangers gradually raised their goals from individual self-improvement to improvement of the farmers' collective plight. In a determined effort to escape the clutches of the trusts, they established cooperatively owned stores for customers and cooperatively owned grain elevators and warehouses for producers, basically co-ops. Their most ambitious experiment was an attempt to manufacture harvesting machinery, but this venture, partly as a result of mismanagement, ended in financial disaster. Embattled Grangers also went into politics, enjoying their most gratifying success in the grain-growing regions of the Upper Mississippi Valley, chiefly in Illinois, Wisconsin, Iowa, and Minnesota. There, through state legislation, they strove to regulate railway rates and storage fees charged by railroads and by operators of warehouses and grain elevators. Many of these state courts, notably in Illinois, were disposed to recognize the principle of public control of private business for the general welfare. A number of so-called Granger laws, however, were badly drawn, and they were bitterly fought through the high courts.
by well-paid lawyers of the interests, corporations. Following judicial reverses, most severely at the hands of the Supreme Court in the famous Wabash decisions of 1886, the Grangers' influence faded, but their organization has lived on as a vocal champion of farm interests while brightening rural life with social activities. Remember, the Wabash court case of the Supreme Court argued that only Congress could regulate interstate travel, and for Illinois to regulate railroad rates was to infringe on Congress's rights, according to the courts. Going back. Farmers' grievances likewise found a vent in the Greenback Labor Party, which combined the inflationary appeal of the earlier Greenbacks with a program for improving the lot of labor. In 1878, the high-water mark of the movement, the Greenback Laborites polled over 1 million votes and elected 14 members of Congress. In the presidential election of 1880, the Greenbackers ran General James B. Weaver, an old Granger who was a favorite among Civil War veterans and who possessed a remarkable voice and bearing. He spoke to perhaps 500,000 citizens in 100 or so speeches, but polled only 3% of the total popular vote. Prelude to populism. A striking manifestation of rural discontent came through the Farmers' Alliance, founded in Texas in the late 1870s. Farmers came together in the alliance to socialize, but more importantly, to break the strangling grip of the railroads and manufacturers through cooperative buying and selling. Local chapters spread throughout the South and the Great Plains during the 1880s. Until by 1890, members numbered more than 1 million hard-bitten souls. Unfortunately, the alliance weakened itself by ignoring the plight of landless tenant farmers and sharecroppers and farm workers. Even more debilitating was the alliance's exclusion of blacks, who counted nearly a half of the agricultural population of the South. In the 1880s, the Colored Farmers National Alliance emerged to attract black farmers, and by 1890, membership numbered more than 250,000. The long history of racial division in the South, however, made it difficult for black and white farmers to work together in the same organization. Out of the Farmers' Alliance came a new political party emerging in the early 1890s, the People's Party, better known as the Populists. These frustrated farmers attacked Wall Street and the Money Trust. They called for, one, nationalizing the railroads, telephones, and the telegraph, instituting a graduated income tax, and three, creating a new federal sub-treasury, a scheme to provide farmers with loans for crops stored in government-owned warehouses, where they could be held until market prices rose. They also wanted the free and unlimited coinage of silver, yet another of the debtors' demands for inflation that echoed continuously throughout the Gilded Age. I'm going to pause and go back real quick. This is a big thing in history. The Populists, or the People's Party, they wanted, one, nationalizing the railroads, telegraphs, and telephones, instituting a graduated income tax, getting taxed more based on how much you made, and creating a new federal sub-treasury, which would provide farmers with loans for crops they would store in government-owned warehouses, and then free and unlimited coinage of silver to encourage inflation. Numerous fiery prophets leapt forward to trumpet the populist cause. The free coinage of silver struck many populists as a cure-all, especially after the circulation of an enormously popular pamphlet entitled Coins Financial School. Written by William Hope Harvey, it was illustrated by clever woodcuts, one of which depicted the gold ogre beheading the beautiful silver maiden. In fiction parading as fact, the booklet showed how the little professor, Coin Harvey, overwhelmed the bankers and professors of economics with his brilliant arguments on behalf of free silver. Another notorious spellbinder was red-haired Ignatius Donnelly of Minnesota. Three times elected to Congress, the queen of the populist calamity howlers was Mary Elizabeth Lease, a tall, athletic woman known as the Kansas Pythoness. She reportedly demanded that Kansas should raise less corn and more hell. The big city New York Evening Post snarled, "We don't want any more states until we can civilize Kansas." To many Easterners, complaint, not corn, was the rural staple crop. Yeah. Yet the populists, despite their oddities, were not to be laughed away. They were leading a deadly earnest and impassioned campaign to relieve the farmers' many miseries. Smiles faded from Republican and Democratic faces alike as countless thousands of populists began to sing, "Goodbye, my party, goodbye." In 1892, the populists had jolted the traditional parties by winning several congressional seats and polling more than 1 million votes of their presidential candidate, James B. Weaver. Racial divisions continued to hobble the populists in the South, but in the West, their ranks were swelling. Could the People's Party now reach beyond its regional bases in agrarian America, join hands with urban workers, and mount a successful attack on the Northeast citadels of power? We'll find out. Coxey's Army and the Pullman Strike. The panic of 1893 and the severe ensuing depression strengthened the populists' argument
that farmers and laborers alike were being victimized by an oppressive economic and political system. Ragged armies of the unemployed began marching to protest their plight. In the growing hordes of displaced industrial toilers, the populists saw potential political allies. The most famous marcher was quote-unquote General Jacob S. Coxey, a wealthy Ohio quarry owner. He set out for Washington in 1894 with a few score of supporters and swarm of newspaper reporters. His platform included a demand that the government relieve unemployment by an inflationary public work program, supported by some $500 million in legal tender notes to be issued by the Treasury. Coxey himself rode in a carriage with his wife and infant son, appropriately named Legal Tender Coxey, with a tiny army tramped along behind singing, "We're coming, Grover Cleveland, 500,000 strong. We're marching on to Washington to right the nation's wrong." The Commonweal Army of Coxeyites finally straggled into the nation's capital, but the invasion took on the aspects of a comic opera when General Coxey and his lieutenants were arrested for walking on the grass. Elsewhere, violent flare-ups accompanied labor protest, notably in Chicago. Most dramatic was the crippling Pullman strike of 1894. Eugene V. Debs, a charismatic labor leader, had helped organize the American Railway Union of about 150,000 members. The Pullman Palace Car Company, which maintained a model town near Chicago for its employees, was hard hit by the Depression and cut wages by about one-third while holding the line on rent for the company houses. The workers finally struck in some places, overturning Pullman cars and paralyzing railway traffic from Chicago to the Pacific Coast. The American Federation of Labor conspicuously declined to support the Pullman strikers, thus enhancing the AF-LF's reputation for quote-unquote respectability, even while weakening labor's cause by driving a large wedge into the workers' ranks. The turmoil in Chicago was serious, but not yet completely out of hand. At least this was the judgment of Governor John Peter Altgeld of Illinois, a friend of the downtrodden, who had pardoned the Haymarket Square anarchists the year before. But U.S. Attorney General Richard Olney, an arch-conservative and ex-railroad attorney, urged for the dispatch of federal troops. His legal grounds were that the strikers were interfering with the transit of the U.S. mail. President Cleveland supported Olney with a ringing declaration, "If it takes the entire Army and Navy to deliver a postcard in Chicago, that card will be delivered." Again, this is an example when you think about it. Context, 1893, the crash of 1893. The 1890s were tough economic times. Many of you in your essays argued that the government was in the hands of big business. Here you actually have an ex-railroad lawyer as the attorney general urging that striking railroad workers be put to work or ended by federal troops. To the delight of conservatives, federal troops bayonets fixed crushed the Pullman strike. Debs was sentenced to 6 months imprisonment for contempt of court because he had defied a federal court injunction to cease striking. Ironically, the lean labor agitator spent much of his enforced leisure reading radical literature, which led to his later leadership of the socialist movement in America. Embittered cries of "government by injunction" now burst from organized labor. This was the first time that such a legal weapon had been used conspicuously by Washington to break a strike, and it was all the more distasteful because defiant workers who were held in contempt could be imprisoned without a jury trial. Signs multiplied that employers were striving to smash labor unions by court action. Non-labor elements of the country, including the populists and other debtors, were likewise incensed. They saw in the brutal Pullman episode further proof of an unholy alliance between business and the courts. So we got the farmers and the workers both devastated by the Panic of 1893. Golden McKinley and Silver Bryan. The smoldering grievances of the long-suffering farmers and the depression-plagued laborers gave ominous significance to the election of 1896. Conservatives of all stripes feared an impending upheaval, while down-and-out husbandmen and discontented workers cast about desperately for political salvation. Increasingly, monetary policy, whether to maintain the gold standard or inflate the currency by monetizing silver, loomed as the issue on which the election would turn. The leading candidate for the Republican presidential nomination in 1896 was former Congressman William McKinley of Ohio, sponsor of the ill-starred Tariff Bill of 1890. He had established a credible Civil War record, having risen to the rank of major. He hailed from the electorally potent state of Ohio, and he could point to long years of honorable service in Congress, where he had made many friends with his kindly and conciliatory manner. As a presidential candidate, McKinley was largely the creature of a fellow Ohioan, Marcus Alonzo Hanna, who made his fortune in the iron business and now coveted the role of president maker. I love McKinley, he once said. As a wholehearted Hamiltonian, Hanna believed that a prime function of government was to aid business. Honest, earnest, tough, and direct, he became the personification of big industry and politics. He was often caricatured in cartoons, quite unfairly, as a bloated bully in a loud checkered suit with a dollar sign in each square. He believed that, in some measure, prosperity trickled down to the laborer, whose dinner pail was full when businesses flourished. Critics assailed this idea as equivalent to feeding the horses in order to feed the sparrows. The hard-headed Hanna, although something of a novice in politics, organized the pre-convention campaign for McKinley with consummate skill and with a liberal outpouring of his own money. The convention steamroller, well lubricated with Hanna's dollars, nominated McKinley on the first ballot in St. Louis in June 1896. The Republican platform cleverly straddled the money question, but leaned towards hard money politics. That's for the gold. It declared for the gold standard, even though McKinley's voting record in Congress had been embarrassingly friendly to silver. The platform also condemned hard times and Democratic incapacity, while outpouring praise on the protective tariff. So gold standard, condemning the Democrats and protecting the industry with tariffs. Dissension riddled the Democratic camp. Cleveland no longer led his party. The Depression had driven the last nail into the political coffin. Dubbed the stuffed prophet, he was undeniably the most unpopular man in the country. Labor debtors groups remembered too vividly his intervention in the Pullman strike, the backstairs Morgan bond deal, and especially his stubborn hard money policies. Ultra-conservative in finance, Cleveland now looked more like a Republican than a Democrat on the money issue. Rudderless, the Democratic convention met in Chicago in July 1896, with Silverites lusting for victory. Shouting insults at the absent Cleveland, the delegates refused, by a pseudocidal vote of 564 to 357, to endorse their own administration. They had the enthusiasm and the numbers. All they lacked was a leader. A new Moses suddenly appeared in the person of William Jennings Bryan of Nebraska. Then only 36 years of age and known as the Boy Orator of the Platte, he stepped confidently onto the platform before 15,000 people. His masterful presence was set off by a peninsular jaw and raven black hair. He radiated honesty, sincerity, and energy. The convention hall setting was made to order for a magnificent oratorical effort. A hush fell over the delegates as Bryan stood before them. With an organ-like voice that rolled onto the outer corners of the huge hall, he delivered a fervent plea for silver. Rising to the supreme heights of eloquence, he thundered, "Will we answer their demands for a gold standard by saying to them, you shall not press down upon the brow of labor this crown of thorns. You shall not crucify mankind upon a cross of gold." The cross of gold speech, which was much more better than what I just did, was a sensation. Swept off his feet in a tumultuous scene, the Democratic convention nominated Bryan the next day on the fifth ballot. The platform demanded inflation through the unlimited coinage of silver at a ratio of 16 ounces of silver to one of gold, though the market ratio was about 32 to 1. This meant that the silver in a dollar would be worth about 50 cents. Democratic gold bugs, unable to swallow Bryan, bolted their party over the silver issue. A conservative senator from New York, when asked if he was a Democrat still, reportedly replied, "Yes, I am a Democrat still, very still." The Democratic minority, including Cleveland, charged that the populist Silverites had stolen both the name and the clothes of their party. They nominated a lost cause ticket of their own, and many of them, including Cleveland, not too secretly hoped for a McKinley victory. The populists now faced a dilemma. Because the Democratic majority had appropriated their main plank, 16 to 1, that heaven-born ratio, the bulk of the populace, fearing a hard-money McKinley victory, endorsed both fusion with the Democrats and Bryan for president, sacrificing their identity in the mix. Singing the jolly silver dollar of the dads, they became, in effect, the Demopop Party, though a handful of the original populists refused to support Bryan and went down with their colors nailed to the mast. So the populists decided to throw in their lot with the Democrats in this situation. Class conflict. Plowholders versus bondholders. Mark Hanna smugly assumed that he could make the tariff the focus of the campaign, but Bryan, a dynamo of energy, forced the free trade issue into the back seat when he took to the stump in behalf of free silver. Sweeping through 27 states and traveling 18,000 miles, he made nearly 600 speeches, 36 in one day, and even invaded the East, the enemy's country. Vachel Lindsay caught the spirit of his oratorical orgy. "Prairie Avenger, Mountain Lion, Bryan, 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 gigantic troubadour speaking like a siege gun, smashing Plymouth Rock with his boulders from the west."
Free silver became almost as much a religious as a financial issue. Hordes of fanatical free Savoyards hailed Bryan as a messiah to lead them out of the wilderness of debt, they saying, "We all have our pockets lined with silver, and no crown of thorn, no cross of gold." Bryan created panic among Eastern conservatives with his threat of converting their holdings overnight into 50-cent dollars. The goldbugs responded with their own free and unlimited coinage verbiage. They vented their alarm in abusive epithets, ringing from fanatic and madman to traitor and murderer. "In God we trust with Bryan we bust," the Republican sneered, while one Eastern clergyman cried, "That platform was made in hell." Widespread fear of Bryan and the silver lunacy enabled Dollar Mark Hanna, now chairman of the Republican National Committee, to shine as a money raiser. He shook down the trust in plutocrats and piled up an enormous slush fund for a campaign of education or propaganda, depending on one's point of view. Reminding the voters of Cleveland's Democratic panic, Republicans appealed to the belly vote with their prize slogan, "McKinley in a full dinner pail." The McKinleyites amassed the most formidable political campaign chest thus far in American history. At all levels, national, state, and local, it amounted to $16 million and contrasted with about $1 million for the poor Democrats, roughly 16 to 1. With some justification, the Bryanites accused Hanna of buying the election and a floating McKinley into the White House in a tidal wave of mud and money. Bryan's cyclonic campaign began to lose steam as the weeks passed. Fear was probably Hanna's strongest ally, as it was Bryan's worst enemy. Republican business people placed contracts with manufacturers contingent on the election of McKinley. A few factory owners, with thinly veiled intimidation, paid off their workers and told them not to come to work on Wednesday morning if Bryan won. Reports also circulated that employees were threatening to pay their employees in 50-cent pieces instead of dollars if Bryan triumphed. Such were some of the dirty tricks of the Stop Bryan, Save America crusade. Hanna's campaign methods paid off. On election day, McKinley triumphed decisively. The vote was 271 to 176 in the Electoral College and 7,102,246 to 6,492,559 in the popular election. Driven by fear and excitement and an unprecedented outpouring of voters flocked to the polls, McKinley rang strongly in the populous East, where he carried every county of New England, and in the upper Mississippi Valley. Bryan's states, concentrated in the debt-burdened South and the trans-Mississippi West, boasted more acreage than McKinley's, but less population. The free silver election of 1896 was perhaps the most significant political turning point since Lincoln's victories in 1860 and 64. Despite Bryan's strength in the South and West, the results vividly demonstrated his lack of appeal in the unmortgaged farmer, and especially to the Eastern urban laborer. Many wage earners in the East voted for their jobs and for full dinner pails. Threatened as they were by free silver and free trade and fireless factories. Living precariously on a fixed wage, the factory workers had no reason to favor inflation, which was the heart of Bryanite's campaign program. The Bryan-McKinley battle heralded the advent of a new era in American politics. At first glance, the election seemed to be the age-old story of the underprivileged many against the privileged few, of the indebted backcountry against the wealthier seaboard, of the country against the city, of the agrarians against the industrialists, of Main Street against Wall Street, of the nobodies against the somebodies. Yet when Bryan made his evangelical appeal to all those supposed foes of the existing social order, not enough of them banded together to form a political majority. The outcome was instead a resounding victory for big business, the big cities, middle-class values, and financial conservatism. Bryan's defeat marked the last serious effort to win the White House with mostly agrarian votes. The future of presidential politics lay not on the farms with their dwindling population, but in the mushrooming cities with their growing hordes of freshly arriving immigrants. A smashing Republican victory of 1896 also heralded the Republican grip on the White House for 16 consecutive years. Indeed, for all but 8 of the next 36 years. McKinley's election thus imparted a new character to the American political system. The long reign of Republican political dominance that it ushered was accompanied by diminishing voter participation in elections, the weakening of party organizations, and the fading away of issues like the money question and civil service reform, which came to be replaced by concern for industrial regulation and the welfare of labor workers. Scholars have dubbed this new political era the period of the fourth party system. Republican stampadism enthroned. An eminently safe McKinley took the inaugural oath in 1897. With his impeccable white vest, he seemed never to perspire, even in oppressively muggy Washington.
Though a man of considerable ability, he was an ear-to-the-ground politician who seldom got far out of line with majority opinion. His cautious, conservative nature caused him to shy away from the flaming banner of reform. Business was given a free rein, and the trust which had trusted him in 1896 were allowed to develop more mighty muscles without serious restraints. Almost as soon as McKinley took office, the tariff issue, which had played second fiddle to silver in the Battle of 96, quickly forced itself to the fore. The current Wilson-Gorman law was not raising enough revenue to cover the annual treasury deficits, and the Republican Trust thought that they had purchased the right to additional tariff protection by their lush contributions to Hanna's war chest. In due course, the Dingley tariff bill was jammed through the House in 1897 under the pounding gavel of the rethroned Czar Reed. The proposed new rates were high, but not high enough to satisfy the paunchy lobbyists who once again descended upon the Senate. Over 850 amendments were tacked onto the overburdened bill. The resulting piece of patchwork finally established the average rates at 46.5%, substantially higher than the Democratic Wilson-Gorman Act of 1894, and in some categories even higher than the McKinley Act of 1890. Prosperity, long lurking around the corner, began to return with a rush in 1897, the first year of McKinley's term. The Depression of 1893 had run its course, and farm prices rose. Paint-thirsty Midwestern barns blossomed in new colors, and the wheels of industry resumed their hum. Republican politicians, like crowing roosters, believing they caused the sun to rise, claimed credit for attracting the sunlight of prosperity. With the return of prosperity, the money issue that had overshadowed politics since the Civil War gradually faded away. The Gold Standard Act of 1900, passed over the last-ditch civil rights opposition, provided that the paper currency be redeemed freely in gold. Nature and science gradually provided an inflation that the gold bug East had fought so frantically to prevent. Electrifying discoveries of new gold deposits in Canada's fabled Klondike, as well as in Alaska, South Africa, and Australia, brought huge quantities of gold onto the world markets, as did the perfecting of the cheap cyanide process for extracting gold from low-grade ore. Moderate inflation thus took care of the currency needs of an explosively expanding nation, as its circulatory system greatly improved. The tide of silver heresy rapidly receded, and the popocratic fish were left grasping high and dry on a golden sanded beach.